What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Daily here, joined by Corrupt Ronin and the one and only Christopher Randolph. How you doing this evening, sir?
I'm very well. Thank you very much. How are you guys?
I'm doing very well. Welcome, Corrupt Ronin, back on to eFusion Week. Well, I guess it's technically your first time. You were here yesterday helping us with the chat and stuff yesterday, so that counts. But welcome on screen for your first day of eFusion Week.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here, and I'm happy to be talking about talking to Christopher Randolph again. This should be a lot of fun.
Yeah. Right. So, Christopher Randolph, for anybody that's been living under a rock for the past few years, who are you and what do you do, sir?
Who am I? Well, I'm an actor and a director, but I'm in this case, I'm mostly known as the voice actor who plays Otacon and Huey in the MGS series. But I do other things too. A lot of stage acting and stage directing, and a few little movies here and there, and a touch of TV, hoping for more someday.
So I just dabble in TV.
I just dabble in TV. Yeah. Yeah.
Just a thing I do every now and then, you know.
So, welcome back. For those of you who don't know, we interviewed Christopher Randolph a little while ago about his work in the Metal Gear Solid series. We're going to talk to him a little bit about that today. As this is eFusion Week, we are mainly focused on current and upcoming projects. Now, please keep in mind, guys, as we spoke to Chris before, there's a lot of stuff that he can't talk about in specifics. But from what we are able to talk about, I think it's going to be just enough to give you guys that little teaser taste that we all like to get when we talk to the voices behind our favorite games. So to start off, Christopher, tell everybody about how it was working on the Phantom Pain. How much had the technology improved from your previous games? This is something we talked about in our last interview, but since we have this new fresh crowd here, let them know exactly what's different about now compared to then.
Oh, Lord, yeah. Well, you know, I mean, if you look, I mean, it's been, I don't know, over 15 years, really, since we really started with MGS1, and the technology has hugely changed. In very interesting ways, and I think also that because the game series is so popular, they have found themselves with more money to play around with. So certainly we've been in better studios and taking advantage of all the advances in technology. So with 5, we're doing, you know, facial capture and motion capture and a lot of really cool technical stuff. And the recording is, in some ways the same, but boy, they're advanced in what they can do. And what they can capture. And, so we were in a really lovely studio, and I could actually sit down, and it was great. It was a lot of fun.
Awesome. Well, thank you for that. Ronan, did you have a question for Chris?
Oh yeah, real quick though, did they use any facial capture? Were you part of the facial capture at all that you can iterate for the crowd that might be new here to this this venue at the moment?
I did a couple days of facial capture for this next one, and it's a really interesting acting challenge, and I cannot wait to see how it looks. Yeah. You know, I mean, I know how it looks, but it'd be interesting to see how I look, because I know what I was doing, and I don't know how that comes across. You know, because it's very technical. You know, they have 16 or 18 infrared cameras all pointing at you from different angles, and you have all these dots all over your face, and it's a really interesting event. So I can't wait. I can't wait to see it.
Yeah, I think we're all excited to get to, like I said, get to play and experience the Metal Gear, the end of the Metal Gear saga that we have experienced throughout these years. Now, when you play Huey in Phantom Pain, did you do any of the motion capture? We know Huey's paralyzed, so I don't know if there's really anything to motion capture for him other than the face. Did you have to do any kind of motion capture work?
Well, I didn't. It was done. It's almost always done by a whole different set of actors who kind of specialize in that. And actually, I think it was actually done in Japan. in advance.
And was
so
your recording done here in the U.S.?
My recording was done in Los Angeles. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
At the L.A. studio.
At the L.A. studios. And, it's one of the interesting challenges is that, I have to match my face and voice on some level to what the body motion capture person did and what they've set up in terms of the way the scene is blocked and stuff. Okay. So for my sessions, I was actually looking at a screen of the body motion capture people, and I had to match what, when and where I turned my head and all that sort of stuff.
Okay, so you've seen kind of like a back-end preview of the game.
It's a bunch of guys, running around in a warehouse, balls on black suits, carrying sort of wooden, like they have sticks if they have guns. And it's really very funny. It's like children playing in a sandbox or something. But
and that will turn into a game that people will experience, which that's just out of this world.
That's amazing.
We tend to take that for granted as gamers. We see the game and we're like, okay, this is the game. But it's really the cover of the game. It's like the face. And then, behind it, you have the skeleton, which obviously looks way different.
Right, exactly. And I mean, it's how this technology is so extraordinary. And it's also how, Mr. Kojima and Konami is extraordinary, because we don't want you to see the skeletons. I probably shouldn't even be talking about the skeleton. we want the player to get totally absorbed in the story and the events and completely get wrapped up in the world. And they managed to do that brilliantly. And it is a long and complicated process to achieve that. So, I think those guys are remarkable. I really do.
Awesome. Ronan, your next question for Mr. Randolph.
Absolutely. So we know that, Huey and Hal, for example, part of the family, so to speak. But what parts of Hal did you take over when doing the voice work for Huey and the Phantom Pain?
How are they connected? That's interesting because, because I did Hal first. I kind of had to reverse engineer Huey. Mm. And there were moments when I slipped a little too far into Hal and we had to, do a take again. But I think they share, obviously, intelligence.
Yes, absolutely.
And they share an extraordinary interest in science and a desire to, I think, develop science and their fields of science for the greater good.
Yeah.
And they are both... they both have their own levels of, kind of passion, and they each have a touch of ego, I think, in their own way.
Yeah, that's absolutely.
I think so far anyway. I think Otacon has maybe a little more sense of humor, but. Huey has a lot more challenges,
Right.
The way they've set it up, and so I think he's fighting through a lot more stuff.
Right. It's interesting to see because they want to create their ideas and technology for the use of good, but they end up being turned into weapons of mass destruction in the end. And it's unfortunate, but yeah, it's interesting to see how the dynamic between these two characters, regardless of the fact that they're related, carries over between two games. And the fact that you have to carry some of Hal's personality a bit over to Huey as well, which is, way before the events of the first Metal Gear Solid, it's interesting to see.
Right. And, it's also kind of good and sort of classic storytelling, I was talking with the writer of one of the plays I'm directing about this whole idea of, the idea of the family dynamic as the American drama and worldwide drama, the sins of the father are visited on the son and, how can we escape our families and all of these questions, which are buried in this thing. And And I think that resonates with people, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Either absolutely. Consciously or unconsciously.
Yeah, I agree.
Definitely. And before we move on to the next question, since you've brought up this point, I've definitely got to congratulate you on your voice work, because like Ronan said, both characters that you've played have wanted to create weapons for good or science for good, and they've end up being turned. And I think you play that really well. Like when you're first introduced to Hal in the first game, he's like, no, Metal Gear's not, you know, this type of weapon. It's this type of weapon. He's very upbeat about his work, and he's, you know, kind of condemning Snake for, you know, what he thought about the work. And then as he's, you know, the plot progresses, you can hear that tone that you bring change in the different levels. And it really just kind of dawned on me right now, the scale, where it's at first, even in Peace Walker with Huey, he seemed really upbeat about what he was creating and stuff like that. And then as soon as it's used for something that it's not intended for, your tone of how you perform definitely changes. And I can see that now. So
thank you. Yeah. And that's all intentional. And, you know, just as an aside, I mean, it's what's going on in the world around us right now.
Yes.
You know,
right.
I think most scientists are really just focused on the science, and they just want to keep advancing the science. And then it goes out into the world, and who knows what they get done with, you know?
Exactly.
So
my next question is, now that you've completed work on the Phantom Pain, do you understand the story as a whole of Metal Gear Solid, at least from the perspective of the characters that you've played?
Well, I understand the stories that the characters go through.
Yes.
In terms of Metal Gear as a whole, I mean, it's so gigantic, which is great, but it's a really huge scoping, sweeping world.
Right.
And
right.
So I don't know as I completely have a grasp, particularly in this upcoming in 5. I don't have a complete grasp of it, you know. I mean, I certainly I haven't seen the full script or you know.
As far as your character is concerned, though, is the story full circle now? Do you finally get all the pieces to the puzzle to put Huey to Hal's legacy?
I think so. Yeah, I think so. I think so. I think what we learn about what happens to Huey, if you go back, you'll begin to realize that it connects very much to the Hal that we all know and love. And I think that's all deliberate, you know.
Awesome.
So, you know, when it comes to portraying the different, you know, tragedies that Hal went through in Metal Gear Solid 1 and Metal Gear Solid 2, I know we talked a bit about this during our last interview, but if for the folks at home that have, you know, that hasn't really had a chance to hear what your thoughts were and what the way you saw those scenes, can you reiterate what it took for you to actually portray the feelings that Otacon was feeling at the time when, let's say, you know, the last moments when Sniper Wolf was dying and, mm-hmm. and giving her last monologue before it was over?
Well, you know, one of the things that makes this whole game so appealing, and I think why so many really, really strong actors love working on this, is that it's written in a way where you can really go to some depths of human emotion, you know, which is what actors do and love to do. And so, you know, with the death of Sniper Wolf or and Emma, all of that, it was very emotional, you know. I have to go to really pretty deep places. With those, we weren't doing motion capture or anything.
Right.
So it's just my voice. So, you know, whatever I look like in the studio in front of the microphone doesn't really matter.
Right.
But I do have to really, I genuinely have to go there. You can't, I don't think you can manipulate your voice in such a way to make that kind of emotion believable. I think you really have to go there and speak from that place.
Right.
And so at least for me, that's the way I have to work. It's the same as any other kind of acting. It's just right. That no one can see you, you know.
Right.
And did that create some sort of like a lot of challenges because of that you had to go through when trying to pull up that place where you pulled this this performance from during those moments?
Yeah, I mean it's challenging, but it, you know, it's kind of what you're there to do.
Yeah.
And so you have to be fluid. And I've said many times, you know, none of us would be anywhere without Chris Zimmerman and her amazing voice direction. And so she is very helpful in guiding us into that place.
Right.
But, you know, the writing helps. The yeah. circumstances help, you know. I mean, if you know, the love of your life is bleeding at your feet, and that's, you know, you just got to put yourself there and then go from there.
That's tough. I don't know if I can do yeah. I don't know if I can do that easily, Chris. And I think if anybody
makes it sound so simple,
if anybody in the franchise has the experience to do that, it has to be you, because unfortunately, as much as we love Otacon and Huey's characters, there's a lot of shit that happens to them. There's no other way to put it other than yeah. bluntly like that. They go through some crazy stuff, and I'm sure even more now in The Phantom Pain. I'm sure there's a deep story that touches on that, because I know the characters might not get too much screen time, but they're all very vital points. We know, based on what we've heard, we're running a little low on time here, so I'm going to be quick. I know, based on what we've heard here through all these announcements that have just come out for this E3 press conference, they've revealed a ton of details about The Phantom Pain, and they revealed that most of the main story will take part in these cassette tapes.
Yeah.
Are we expecting to hear some cassette tapes from Huey?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Very, very excited to hear some of that. It's definitely different. Normally, you know, in a game like Metal Gear, we get codec calls and we have to pause the gameplay and listen this way. So now, while we're traveling from location to location, we can get the real story behind Huey and whatever's going on in the Phantom Pain, which seems to be absolutely crazy. Guys, Christopher has not seen the new trailer that's been released, and it's a very dark trailer, and it really hits on some key points that maybe the Snake that we're seeing now is not necessarily all there, and there's a lot of different issues that come into play. We see Huey being beaten and stuck with a syringe and all sorts of stuff, so there's a lot that he has to do with that. And I've heard some of the tapes that you've had in Ground Zero. My last question is, how is recording the tapes different from recording the actual voiceovers?
You know, it's really not all that different, because they can manipulate the sounds and make it sound like it's coming from a tape, as opposed to the fact that it's live and all that sort of stuff. So it's not really all that different. But it is, as you point out, it's really kind of a cool way to structure things.
Right,
and I think it'll hold people's interest. You know, it's very clever. It's very, very clever. And yes, Huey goes through some really, really tough. Yeah, he goes through some shit. There's no question. that's the right word.
That's okay.
Exactly. All right. So, Ronan, your last question for Mr. Randolph.
Absolutely. So, there were a lot of, even at this moment, there's a lot of people that are talking about the fact that perhaps Snake or Kiefer Sutherland doesn't really have that much voice work in this title because of the fact that a lot of it's being expressed through cassette tapes, and they want to focus on the gameplay aspect of it this time around. So my question to you is, how much dialogue would you say that you had to go through this time around as opposed to the previous entries in the series, like Metal Gear Solid 2 or 1 or perhaps Peace Walker, for example?
Right. There was less this time.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that was for various reasons. It was maybe not less than Peace Walker.
Okay.
But, you know, I think I sort of look at it in a different way, which is that Otacon, particularly in 2 and 4, was such a conduit to the player. With advice and all those codec pop-ups and you know all the training information and information about weaponry and all of that kind of stuff.
Right.
To be sort of the player's aid, if you
right.
will.
Right.
So there was a lot more to do there. And you know, Huey is that's not Huey's role.
Right.
And he's got Huey has a very, very, I think, a key role in this upcoming game. But it's less about what he says.
Okay.
Although he says plenty, don't get me
right.
wrong. but it's less about volume. I okay. mean, not volume, but amount.
Right, right,
of course.
Yeah.
All right. So to close out the interview, thank you, Ron. That was a great question. The chat loved that. To close out, Chris, tell us what you're working on, video game or non-video game related. I know the fans are interested to hear what one of their favorite people are up to in the world. Do you have any games coming up? And if not, what are some of the other things that you're working on?
At the moment, I don't have any games. I would love to do some more games. You know, I do a lot of work in the theater. And actually, this summer, I'm directing a couple of shows, one here in New York City. It's a play called The International, which we produced last year, about a little over a year ago. Mm-hmm. We have an opportunity to remount it at a bigger and better theater. So it'll be running for 3 weeks towards the end of July at the Peter J. Sharp Theater at Playwrights Horizons here in Manhattan. It's a terrific play about war and the consequences of war and the victims of war.
Fitting.
And it's really terrific.
Right.
So I'm directing that, and then I'm directing a play up in Boston, of all places, my hometown, a play called I Shut Door Open, about an artist and the origins of art and what makes you create art. And
again, a fitting name.
Yes,
seriously. Seriously.
Exactly.
So if you're in Boston or New York, guys, make sure you go show some love to Christopher Randolph. Go check out his plays and some of the stuff that he's directing. I think that would be an amazing thing to see.
Yeah, it's great. And you know, beyond that, I'm hoping to do more games, and I'm looking into, you know, maybe trying to go to the New York Comic Con in October if
awesome.
I can. And I've never done a Comic Con before, you know, I would love to.
I would love to.
Someday I'd love to do E3, but this is the closest I've gotten. So thank you guys.
Well, you're so welcome, and thank you. We look forward to seeing what you're working on next. Hopefully, with all of these new indie companies getting Kickstarters and stuff like that, I don't know if you've heard, but there was a game that was Kickstarted, and one of the stretch goals was David Hayter as a voice actor.
Yep. Oh, no kidding. Yeah.
And they hit it within hours. I think
I
it was $800,000+ in just a couple hours. And so David Hayter is now reprising a role as a villain in a Castlevania-type game. And so it'll be interesting because I don't think we get to see David as a villain very much. But hopefully those kinds of Kickstarter campaigns and indie campaigns will be able to actually fund and reach out to, you know, great voice actors like yourself with this new medium that we have here in the game.
I think
industry.
That's brilliant. I really do. I think it's brilliant because, you know, that then you can really get what you want, you know.
Exactly.
And by the way, David would be a fantastic villain. So, you know.
No doubt. Well, thank you so much, Christopher Randolph, for joining us. Everybody, follow Christopher Randolph on Twitter at ChristophRan and stay up to date on everything that he's doing. Thank you so much for all of your time. Hopefully, this will not be the last time we have you on the show and we can talk to you again here in the future.
Anytime. I look forward to it.
I love it.
Thank
you so much, sir.
Thank you.
We appreciate all of your insight on everything. Have a great rest of the day. And we're going to be sure to send you a link to see the new Metal Gear Solid trailer.
Yeah, please do. I really want to see that.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Chris. Enjoy your day.
Thank you. You too. Take care.
Goodbye.
Have a good one.
Bye.